Hey, I'm Mike Gilliam, and this is Let It Rip. We still have not reached President Biden and Vice President Kamala Harris's first 100 days in office, but we're starting to see a major difference in both priorities and accomplishments from the previous administration. We'll look at some of that by focusing on what President Biden did with the historic $1.9 trillion COVID-19 plan and what it means to Black farmers and childhood poverty. Welcome to Let It Rip. You know, if you live in the city, farming and Black farmers in particular might be something you seldom think about. But there's a history to be told, and it has everything to do with our history and discrimination. In 1920, at its peak, there were nearly 1 million Black farmers in America. Today, according to the U.S. Department of Agriculture, or USDA, only 1.3% of the country's 3.4 million farmers, or about 45,000, are Black. They own a little over one half of 1% of America's farmland, while a whopping 95% of farmers in the U.S. are white. Black farmers lost 90% of their land, and a lot of the problem stems from the USDA and its widely reported discriminatory and predatory policy. But help is on the way. The recently passed $1.9 trillion COVID relief bill earmarks $5 billion in aid made up largely of debt relief to farmers of color. This is meant to right a lot of wrongs. Black farmers have complained that the USDA shut them out of loans or delayed approvals. Black farmers received just $21 million in farm subsidies, while white farmers got $8.9 billion, according to a 2002 report. So, where do we go from here, and will this correct the problem? We're joined by Distinguished Lecturer Emeritus at York College, Dr. Ron Daniels. Dr. DeWeston Haywood, who is a 20th century historian researching and teaching Black protests and protests at Hunter College, and a board member of the Nat Turner Farm in Southampton, Virginia, and founder of the African American International Merchants Agency, Rachel Clark. Ron, this is something that was really needed for Black farmers. Otherwise, they could have become extinct, right?
Well, not only that, there's a long history, as you talked about it, in terms of not only the loss of Black farmers, but the loss of Black land. And part of that takes place within the context of the mechanization and conglomerization of farming as well. So when you talk about some of those individual white farmers, some of them are huge farmers. This is the second bite at the apple, so to speak, because there was a Pickford decision, because I have worked with some of these farmer organizations. And so under Obama, there was a settlement which provided some relief for some of the farmers. It was just not enough. And so this is an effort on the part of the Biden administration to extend that. But it's also a recognition that, of course, these rural areas, you know, that there are Black farmers who need help, and they're willing to support building out, you know, supporting a political candidate who finally recognizes their needs in a way that historically conservatives and Republicans have not. So this is an important first step, and there may be more help on the way.
Mm-hmm. DeWeston, put this loss of Black farming into perspective for us.
Right. So I think much of American history, and Black history in particular, is a story about land and fraught disputes over ownership, access to, or the lack thereof. And I think, as many of the comments have already highlighted, and especially in some of those stats that you point out, Black farmers is another way of saying Black ownership. And in some of the federal policies, even though we have this moment where Biden is using his administration to answer some of these historic wrongs, but some of these federal policies were responsible for alienating Black ownership of land, property, real estate. So much of Black history has to do with Black people trying to gain access to some of the fundamentals of citizenship in this country. And in many ways, to own is to be citizen, right? So if you have ownership of some material thing, real estate in this case. You also have ownership of your time, your body, your mobility, your labor, and land is so much tied up in that, right? So we'll see if this historic moment from the Biden administration to address these things will remedy historic wrongs or just continue more of the same.
It also involves being able to pass that wealth down, pass that land down from generation to generation. Rachel, how difficult has it been for Black farmers to survive, let alone compete with white farmers?
It's extremely sad because of our colors, because we're Black or Africans or African Americans. We have not experienced the luxury of getting loans. We have not experienced the luxury of really getting that 40 acres of ewe and mule. So we come with a generation lack of wealth, lack of ownership. And so in order for us to get justice in that area, my personal opinion is that certainly the $5 billion is welcome, but I think that we need to really address the real concern of the Black Americans here in America when we look at reparations. When we talk about reparations, what is the reparations for us to have land ownership? We need to have land ownership in order to build and be independent and to do for ourselves. Then how are we going to acquire that if the door is locked to us when it comes to loans, it's locked to us when it comes to grants? We're discriminated against because of who we are. And when the discrimination is coming from the top, not the bottom, but the top, where the access of wealth is, then how do we fight that? How do we fight the USDA against their discriminatory practices?
I think a lot of people might wonder what you mean when you say the USDA's discriminatory practices. Talk to me a little bit about some of the problems we've had in dealing with the USDA, a federal agency.
Yes. Well, we talk about how data and information was withheld or exaggerated or underrepresented and just the way they provided the services to one who was an African American.
Mm-hmm. So there were problems with loans. I understand that at times it took four times longer for an African-American to get a loan from the USDA. There were problems in that area, not to mention the problems with getting commercial banks to lend for the equipment that you need to work that land. Is that correct?
Absolutely, absolutely. That is the experience out at the Nat Turner land. You know, there some farmers are forced to lease their land to other farmers or white farmers to use because they don't have the equipment to develop it themselves. Though they have ownership of the land, they don't have equipment to process that land into a successful farming. So when you look at the situation, it's really sad because now you're still locked into a discriminatory process because even if you have acquisition of the land or some land, you don't have acquisition of equipment to till your land and to be a successful farmer as other farmers are.
Ron, she mentioned reparations and you've done a lot of work along the lines of reparations. Do you think that what was done in this bill was meant to maybe provide reparations with different messaging or does this fall far short?
Well, let me address that question, but let me just also speak to some of the issues that Rachel was talking about, because I think there are several layers of it. Number one, we have to look at the agricultural extension agents. The agricultural extension agents are often the entry point for many of these farmers in terms of getting the technical assistance and so forth. And they frankly did not service African-American farmers in the same way. The other reality is we're talking in an era of agro-business. We don't use that term very often. Mm-hmm. Many African-American farmers are limited, what we call limited resource farmers. They have, some have lots, thousands and thousands of acres of land, but many of them don't. Many of them are smaller. So the question becomes, how do you compete as a limited resource farmer in the age of agribusiness? And there are ways to do that, direct farm, farm to market projects and so forth, which I've also had some experience in working on. The other thing is the good news. The good news is that the Biden administration has mandated that an equity lens be applied to all areas of government moving forward. In other words, looking at how the disparities can be eliminated and so forth. So though these were things that you could count that were a part of the past, they are not now a part of the future. And indeed, the whole issue of access to capital and technical assistance and capital formation is also a part of the Biden's Lift Every Voice a Black Agenda, which many people aren't even aware that he has. But there is a Lift Every Voice Black Agenda, which Biden, you know, has advanced. As it relates to reparations, I know that one of the leaders of the farmers, and I'm blanking on his name, I've actually done some work with him, was reluctant to have the term reparations applied to it. But in a way, this was reparative. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, Rachel is right. We have to then, and we're working on this now through H.R. 40, the bill to, in fact, create a commission to study and develop reparations proposals for African Americans, which is about to become law in the next, I would say, 90 days. Land will become a big part of that. You know, getting blocks of land and helping limited resource farmers and others to have the sufficient aggregation of resources and equipment in order to compete in a global world on the scale of agribusiness. So I think that reparations is certainly a part of the 10-point program that the National African American Reparations Commission has put forward. And we certainly are going to be pushing that land be a critical part of any reparations settlement.
Okay. DeWeston, are there other areas that this model could be helpful in, the things that the Biden administration is doing here?
Yeah, I think so. Much to the earlier points, if we're using the word reparations or not, I think Dr. Daniels' phraseology of reparative is crucial because it helps us begin the work rather than moving, producing another study, let's say of Black farmers or even reparations, that the study now moves toward development, implementation, mm-hmm. right? And these aren't questions so much for other segments and populations of the American populace, right? So it's to make the point that here is the beginning. And I think it requires critical grassroots work. I think it requires critical building of relationships between people at the grassroots and leaders in the governmental sector to produce this kind of legislation and these kinds of efforts. But I do think it's a beginning. If we begin to calculate what reparations might look like, I mean, we're talking, some scholars estimate between $250 to $350 billion, and that's still the tip of the iceberg, right? That's not the beginning in all ways, but also it's this idea that reparations, if we're talking about from slavery, or we could also talk about reparations from failures of the federal state during the New Deal, where Black people who owned land, farmers, or even Black people who owned, let's say, coastal properties, were stripped of that land by the federal government and by businesses to make that land available for leisure or for white farmers. Right, so I think the reparations argument is broad. It extends from slavery and it can even extend from our modern moment in the 1930s.
Ah, great discussion. I think a lot of people don't realize the history of Black farmers and what they've been going through over the years. I want to thank our guests, Ron Daniels, Distinguished Lecturer Emeritus at York College, historian DeWeston Haywood from Hunter College, and a board member of the Nat Turner Farm in Southampton, Virginia, Rachel Clark. We're going to take a short break, and when we come back, we'll dig deeper into the Biden administration's policies designed to dramatically cut childhood poverty. I'm Mike Gilliam, and this is Let It Rip.
You're watching CUNY TV, the City University of New York.
Welcome back to Let It Rip. I'm Mike Gilliam. We're taking a look at some of the Biden administration's priorities and policies aimed specifically at African Americans and other people of color. The COVID relief bill also takes aim at childhood poverty. The bill resembles one passed in Britain. Most families here will get $300 per child paid monthly for each child five and under, and $250 a month for older children. Benefits phase out for families making six-figure incomes. Studies show that this will reduce child poverty from 14% down to about 6%, and mostly will affect Black and Hispanic students. That is huge, and it can affect many aspects of a child's life. Here to continue our discussion, we have the director of the TCC Child Learning and Performance Arts Center, Tyliba Iman. Welcome. And Ron Daniels, lecturer and founder of and president of the Institute of the Black World 21st Century, has agreed to stay with us as well. Ron, what do you make of this aspect of the COVID plan? You know, many say it's the most significant part of the overall plan, and it's big, like Social Security.
No, it is significant. And I think what's important about it is in previous public policy, there was almost always a trickle up, a trickle down effect. Where, you know, the policy had to go through a lot of bureaucracy and so forth. What's happening with this? These are direct payments that are going direct into the accounts of people on a monthly basis, which is incredibly powerful because they have control of it, over it. I understand they can even budget it if they choose to and so forth. So I see this as a hugely powerful piece of legislation reminiscent of the New Deal, actually. The question I have is, will they make it permanent? I'm not sure that they've made that decision yet. I think there's certainly some commitment on in that direction. But if we can make this permanent, this will be a game changer.
Yeah, right now it's only for 1 year, but the hope is that people will like this and it will go forward as a permanent sort of thing. Tyliba, you work with children. How important is this?
This is a game changer. As many anti-poverty scholars talk about the fact that this has the potential to really eradicate poverty for half of American children. So you could imagine children under 5 years old being able to get $3,600 for the year and being able to budget that out monthly. Like Dr. Daniels has said, it would afford parents the opportunity to really be able to give those children those resources that they need for after school programs and extracurricular activities and things that will really pivot us forward versus backward.
How will cutting childhood poverty improve lives, not just when they are young, but for a person's entire life?
The trajectory for our counterparts are very different, vastly different. As we know, Black, Native American, and Latino children are marginalized and in the poverty category. So this will enable parents to have the resources that they need for exposure. And as we know, exposure is the gateway to changing of your legacy. So for the educational benefits alone, it's imperative that this happens and is sustained.
Ron, you touched on a point there that's very interesting and very important, and that is that those payments are going directly to people and they can budget them. But there are some on the other side who said, hey, this is wrong. This is going to be a disincentive for people to work. But that hasn't been proven out over the years in other areas where they've done this, correct?
Well, not only that, what this is really also opening the door to is something that Martin Luther King talked about near the end of his life. It doesn't get a lot of coverage, but at the end of his life, Martin Luther King was really fighting for four basic human rights, one of which was a guaranteed annual income, that every human being in this society, irrespective of race, color, and so forth, should not fall beneath a certain floor. And so they would have a basic living wage or a living income. That's now being translated into something called, as you well know, universal basic income. And what's happening is in city after city where people are experimenting with this, they're not finding this disincentive that people are talking about. They're not finding this whole idea that people are reckless, don't know how to spend their money and so forth. And by the way, they don't apply the same standard to people who have wealth and people who are squandering and not paying their taxes and so forth and so on. So I think this is an incredibly powerful idea. I think that it's important too, because it disabuses people of the notion that people can't manage their own affairs. People can't manage when there's nothing to manage. I mean, when you're going, in my community, we say we're going from pillar to post, so to speak. There's these, you know, scratching and scraping. And when you're scratching and scraping, it's hard for you to be that home educator, that home person who is working with the teachers, working with the educational system, because you're just fighting for survival.
Taliba, one of the things that we often don't think about is the fact that a lot of kids are facing food insecurity issues. Do you expect that this will help with that area?
Absolutely. Educational facilities like my own and many others throughout the city do provide food for children, whether it's after school or during the day. So parents having the resources to actually send their children will afford them the opportunity of everything that we have to offer, which do include meals. And we know that that is the cornerstone to get them active. Kids can't perform on an empty stomach. It just doesn't work. Mm-hmm.
Ron, are there other areas where you see this as being helpful as well?
Well, I think, and that's why it's so important. There's so many, when you look at the intersection of issues, there's so many that are important in terms of eliminating poverty. And by the way, I'm glad we're talking about 50%, but you know, ultimately we ought to be talking about how to eliminate poverty, period. And I think this opens the door up. And I think the real tension is between those who really just do not believe that people have the ability to run their own lives in an effective way. And that's being, that myth is being eroded. But it also is going to be important, quite frankly, for those of us who are advocates and organizers to have people be aware of, you know, what's happening in American society in terms of the ability to support these programs so that we become a political base for the liberal, progressive, expansive notion of what it means to be a human being.
It hasn't been 100 days yet since Biden and Harris took office, but so far, how would you rate their performance when it comes to people of color and campaign promises? Ron, you first.
Well, I think I would give them a B+, because a lot of people are not aware, and is that there is a specific Biden Black agenda, and one of the first executive orders that was signed was an executive order on equity. He said, I have your back, and I gotta be honest. You know, when Clyburn said, we know Joe, and I said, oh yeah, okay, let's see. But he is standing up, and Joe is delivering on the promise in so many different ways. And by the way, Lift Every Voice agenda, there's a lot of resources, for example, for historical Black colleges and universities. That is going to unleash a lot of creativity, and many of our leaders have come from these institutions that are on the margins now. There's resources, and again, for access to credit and for technical assistances for small businesses, tremendous amount, and affordable housing. A tremendous amount of money has been allocated for affordable housing, because if you can't afford a dwelling in a place like New York or Chicago and so forth, then you're really in. So they have really targeted small businesses as well as affordable housing as a key agenda item. So I give them high marks so far.
Mm-hmm. How about you, Taliba?
I'm with Mr. Daniels. I give them a B. I don't want to do an A just yet because we're kind of new. But this, the child tax credit, nothing of the sort has been done since 1997. We know it's not new. However, to have this amount of money being pumped into the hands of parents, I think is remarkable. The equity issues that are on the table are another thing that are really, really just moving us in the right direction. So I say a strong B, definitely.
Mm-hmm. Okay, good, good. We'll have to leave it right there. Lots of insight into some bold moves being taken by the Biden administration. I want to thank our guests, the director of the TCC Child Learning and Performance Arts Center, Taliba Iman, and Ron Daniels, lecturer and founder and president of the Institute of the Black World 21st Century. Thank you both. We'll take a quick break, and I'll be back with some final thoughts in just a minute. I'm Mike Gilliam, and this is Let It Rip.
You're watching CUNY TV, the City University of New York.
Welcome back to Let It Rip. I'm Mike Gilliam. Now for some final thoughts. The Biden administration has made some bold moves in the early days of their first term. While tackling the distribution of the COVID vaccine, they've made some big strides in a lot of areas and without the support of Republicans. Black farmers could stand a fighting chance now that there's been movement on loan forgiveness and the playing field looks like it may become closer to level. Will that bring more Blacks back into farming? Well, that's hard to say. Many could be lost forever. But for those hanging on, this could be very welcome relief. On childhood poverty, the moves made in the COVID relief bill are simply put huge. If life follows the studies that have been done on other cuts to child poverty around the world, a lot of good can come of the administration's move to create much better lives for our children and their families. Giving them a so-called financial cushion should really help young families struggling to make it through the pandemic and beyond. Right now, it looks good, even though many on the other side are complaining. Didn't hear from them while young children and their families suffer. So, to the administration, I'd say, so far, so good, but don't let up. That's it for now. I'm Mike Gilliam. We'll see you next time on Let It Rip.